The Reality of Sin and Depravity, Part 2. Now, one of the things, as you read through passages of Scripture like this, that it's so important for us to keep in our minds, because you know how people do. They read Scripture and they just bring things to it instead of getting things out of it. And one of the things that's important as we read these words, that what Paul is describing, the people that Paul is describing here in these verses, involves and describes and includes all natural people. What the Bible calls the natural man. You know, the Bible, in many different ways and many different situations, divides the whole world up into two categories of people. I've often said there's only two kinds of people on this earth. There are sinners lost in their sins, and there are sinners saved by the grace of God. There's no in between there. And you're either a sinner lost in your sins or a sinner saved by the grace of God. You could call it unbelievers and believers. You can call it unregenerate and regenerate. Not born again, born again, all of that. Well, the natural man, as you know, describes all unregenerate people. That's as we are naturally born. We fell in Adam. We're all born dead spiritually in trespasses and sins. And that's the natural man. Now, once God brings us to, gives us spiritual life and brings us to faith in Christ and repentance, once we're born again, we're spiritual people. Now, that doesn't mean that, and when you talk about natural people, unregenerate people, you're not necessarily talking about people who do not appear outwardly righteous. You're not talking about people who are necessarily not religious, not moral in the eyes of men. And at the same time, when you talk about spiritual people, the spiritual man, the spiritual woman, you have to realize that we don't always act spiritually, do we? Paul talked about the Corinthians there, how he says you're acting carnally. That means fleshly, the way you're acting because of their divisions, because of their behavior. He says you're acting carnally. And he was instead of condemning them, he sought to recover them. So when we look at this, what Paul's talking about here is the natural man. And he says in 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 14, he says, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, neither can he know them. They're spiritually discerned. So when he says in verse 10, there's none righteous, no, not one, what's he talking about? Now, we know that God's elect are righteous in Christ, don't we? The Bible says that. We know that God says in the Word that those to whom he chose before the foundation of the world and gave to Christ, that he does not charge them with their sins. He says, who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? They have Christ's righteousness imputed to them. So we can say we are righteous in Christ by the grace of God, based upon his righteousness imputed. But here's what Paul's talking about. As we are born naturally, fallen in Adam, spiritually dead in trespasses and sin, in ourselves or by our works, there's none righteous, no, not one. You see, I am not a righteous person in myself. Do you understand that? In myself, I'm a sinner. Now, I'm a sinner saved by grace, and I am righteous in Christ. And you got to make that distinction, or you won't understand the Bible at all. I can claim righteousness without embarrassment, but it's all Christ. I think it was one of the old reformers who said it's an alien righteousness. That means it's not in me, it's not of me, it didn't come from me, and I didn't work it out. It's all Christ. Bunyan said, my righteousness is in heaven, and that's Christ, Jesus Christ the righteous. But what Paul's talking about here is why we need Christ's righteousness imputed. And the reason I need his righteousness imputed is this: there's none righteous, no, not one. And then he says, there's none that understandeth, none that seeketh after God. Verse 12, they're all gone out of the way, they're together become unprofitable, there's none that doeth good, no, not one. Now, that's the sin and depravity of man. The sin meaning we all fall short. Nothing I do even in my best attempts to obey God, will measure up to the perfection of righteousness. And let me tell you something. This is where the one of the points, or you might even say the main point, where the enmity of natural man comes out against God is when you tell the natural man, God requires perfection. And of course, I mentioned this last week, how, well, they say that's not fair. Well, it is fair. It's the only thing God can require because he's God, but it's also fair because God has provided what he requires by his grace in Christ. We just by nature don't want it that way. We want it some other way. So he says that, so all of this, he's showing the sin and depravity of man. The sin, we all fall short. The depravity comes out in what he talks about in verse 11 and 12. None understand it. They don't understand. We don't, by nature, we don't understand God's way, who God is, who we are, who Christ is, how God saves sinners, how God can be just and justify the ungodly. We don't understand the concept of righteousness imputed. All we can understand by nature is we got to be good enough to get there. You know, I've got to do enough good works, or I've got to make a decision, or I've got to walk an aisle. That's all we understand by nature. You tell persons, give some, you know, what must I do to be saved? Well, you give a person something to do, they'll do it. But just to depend upon another person for my whole salvation, now that's one thing the natural man won't have. And so he says, there's none that seeketh after God, the true and living God, as he reveals himself in the Word. Man's got a lot of gods, and they're all very similar to his main God, himself. And you know how they do with idolatry. They give their idol gods. We give our idol gods as natural people before regeneration. We give our idol gods attributes like ourselves. And that's how it ends up. He says they're all gone out of the way of Christ, the way of grace, God's way. They've got other ways. There is a way that seems right unto a man, natural man, but it's a way of death. It's the broad way that leads to destruction. Many are on it because that's what we're naturally on. Why are so many people flocking to the broad way? Because it's natural to us. It just seems right to us until God intervenes. And then he says, there's none that doeth good, no, not one. Now remember, that's good in God's measure of good, God's standard of goodness, not mine and yours, see, but God's standard. Now, from verses 13 all the way down to verse 20, he gives us the two ways that man reveals his natural depravity. And here are the two ways. The first way is by what he speaks. By what he speaks. And look at it in verse 13 and 14. Their throat is an open sepulcher. You know what an open sepulcher is? It's an open grave. Their throat. With their tongue, they have used deceit. You know, James talked a lot about the tongue, didn't he? The poisonous tongue, all right? The poison of asp is under their lips. Verse 14, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Now that's the way man speaks. And then the next way man reveals his depravity is his ways. You might say his way of walking, his way of conducting himself, his conversation. You know, a lot of times in the Bible, the word conversation it means more than just having an oral conversation. It means how you walk, how you conduct yourself. And this is what he says in verse 16, destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace they've not known. There's no fear of God before. Now, I'm going to get to that next week, but I want to focus in today, verses 13 and 14, on man's words. You've heard the saying, sticks and stones may hurt my bones, may break my bones, but words can never hurt me. Wrong. Words can hurt. Words can be deadly. Words can be poisonous. What kind of words are poisonous? And I'll tell you, as I'm studying for this lesson and writing the lesson out here, it just, I'll tell you, it comes, it just reminds me of how careful I need to be when I'm standing here behind this pulpit and I'm speaking words. That I tell you the truth. That I tell myself the truth. That I tell you what we need to hear, not necessarily what we want to hear. And that I speak mainly, that I speak the word of God and not the word of men. I don't want to just get up here and ramble on and just tell you what's on my mind, because what's on my mind may not be what you need to hear. And certainly it might not be what I want you to hear. But I want to speak the word of God. And that's what I'm talking about. These verses speak of the natural sinfulness and depravity of man's speech. And let me tell you something right off. He's not just talking about people telling dirty jokes. He's not just talking about people using cuss words. I understand that. Is that sinful? Is it bad? Yes. Somebody said, we better be careful how we speak because God's going to judge every idle word. Well, you know, we all speak idle words. Listen, you know what an idle word is? It's a vain, it's an empty word. Worthless speech. You ever talk throughout the week about stuff that doesn't mean a thing, you know? Well, of course, we all speak idle words. But the idle words that he's talking about, and that's from Matthew chapter 12, by the way, and I've got that referenced in your lesson. The idle words that he's talking about is not just us talking, even sinful talking. He's talking about false doctrine, folks. He's talking about religious talk. He's talking about a false gospels. Now, that's the issue here. What's Paul's subject in this whole context here? It's how God justifies sinners based upon his grace through the righteousness of another. And he's showing here why we need God's grace, why we need Christ, why we need the righteousness of another, why we need his blood to save us from our sins. All right? So that if I get up here and I talk to you about some other way, that's idle talk. That's vain. See, look at it, verse 13. Their throat is an open sepulcher. What he's talking about here is death. You see, people today have this attitude. Your doctrine doesn't matter. It's how you live. Well, my friend, that is anti-Christ. It's anti-biblical. Everything that we are, as far as a right relationship with God, in the revelation of that, who I am and what I am, begins with my doctrine. And if unless that's settled, it doesn't matter how you're trying to appear outwardly. You say, what did Paul say in Galatians 1 about the false preachers that had crept into Galatia? He said, the we, now who's the we there? Apostles. Or an angel from heaven. Preach what? Any other gospel to you than that which we have preached. Let him be anathema. So here, you know, can you get any better than the appearance of an apostle? Can you get any better than the appearance of an angel? But if they preach another gospel, a different kind, salvation by works, salvation conditioned on sinners, let them be anathema. That's an evidence that they're cursed of God. That's what he's saying. That's why we need Christ, who became a curse for us. He says, their throat is an open sepulcher. With their tongues they've used deceit, deception. Now, if you know anybody who is just known as by reputation as being a liar in the affairs of people, like a liar in financial matters, a liar in family matters or something like that, you don't want to be around them. You don't want to listen to them. You don't trust them. And certainly that's sinful. It sure is. But the deceit that he's talking about is the deception of false religion, which leads sinners on the broad road that leads to destruction. Think about the Pharisees. He says the poison of asp is under their lips. That's false doctrine. What did he say? John the Baptist, you vipers. Why did he call them poisonous snakes? It's because they were teaching a false doctrine based upon the works of people and not on the grace of God. That's why the Baptist said, bring forth fruits meet for repentance. You need to repent of that. If you know a person who's a liar, you'd say, if you want them to repent, you'd say, well, you need to stop lying and start telling the truth. Well, is there any place where that's more needed than in the churches, where men and women are standing and telling sinners how God saves sinners if they're telling a lie? Will those words hurt? It'll hurt anybody that believes them, because they're on the broad road that leads to destruction. Their throat is an open sepulcher, an open grave. That's quoted from Psalm 5:9. I've got it listed there in your lesson. Listen to it. For there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part. Now, what is the inward part? That's the heart. He says, their inward part is very wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulcher. They flatter with their tongue. Flattery. You ever been around a person who uses flattery all the time? Well, that's what a false preacher does. Every time he tells himself and his people that they're saved based on anything other than the grace of God in the righteousness of Christ, he's using flattery. Anytime he talks about how sinners have met certain conditions to be saved, to stay saved, to earn their rewards, he's using flattery. But that inward part, that's the heart. The inward part, that's the heart. Look over at Matthew chapter 12. Thought I had it marked in my Bible here, but I didn't. But look at Matthew chapter 12. Now, Christ taught the disciples this on several occasions. And I think I've got another passage listed there in Matthew 15. Matthew 12, Matthew 15. You got to understand, how do people by nature think about sin? See? What is sin in the Bible? Well, it's falling short of the glory of God. Where is the glory of God found? In Christ. His glorious person, his finished work, his righteousness, his blood. So anything that I say to you concerning salvation and a right relationship with God that doesn't meet up to his standard as found in Christ by his grace, do you know what it is? It's sin. If I point you anywhere, let's say we got a problem. Let's say, just like in Corinth, you remember they were abusing the Lord's Supper. Okay? So Paul's going to correct that. He's going to tell them, now what you're doing is wrong. What you're doing is sinful. And he even said this. He said that some of you are even getting sick and dying over this thing. Now you got to correct it. But how are you going to do that? Well, you've got to do that in a way that glorifies God. So you've got to recover people and correct people, reprove in a way of grace and not lay the black whip of the law on them or dangle the carrot of mercenary reward in front. You see what I'm saying? You got to glorify God in whatever you do, however you encourage people to walk right, to live right. And if you encourage them in any other way, you're not glorifying God. It's sinful. Brother Mahan used to talk about preachers who would preach on giving. You know, you either give or God's going to carry it out the back of the church in a pine box. That kind of thing. Give or burn. That kind of thing. Well, should God's people give? Yes. But out of the heart, out of love and grace and gratitude. You wouldn't have a thing you have if it weren't for God. Did you know that? Whatever you got. Whether it's little or whether it's a lot, you wouldn't have it. You say, well, I worked hard for it. Well, still God gave it to you. What if you were born paralyzed? Or Charles Krauthammer died. He was paralyzed from the neck down. What if you were that way? Of course, he did well even that way. But it's all a gift from God, isn't it? Everything we have, our intelligence, our desires, our ability to work, our opportunities, it's all a gift from God. See? So give, yeah. Give out of the love of your heart, you know. Thank you, Lord. See, that's good stewards. All right. Well, look here at Matthew chapter 12. Look over at, let's see. He's talking about blaspheming against the Holy Spirit here, and you know how people do. They call that the unpardonable sin. There is no unpardonable sin. I've already dealt with it, I think. And, you know, listen, the blood of Jesus Christ covers all sin. What he's talking about is those who reject Christ have no means or ground of forgiveness. That's what he's talking about. But look at verse 31. He says, "Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, and the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men." What is the work of the Holy Ghost? It's to convince us of sin, of righteousness, of judgment, and drive us to Christ. That's what he's talking about. Verse 32. "And whoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven." Now again, Saul of Tarsus spoke words against the Son, didn't he? He sure did. He called Christ a blasphemer, a malefactor, accursed, a devil. That's what all the Pharisees called him, Jesus of Nazareth. But when the Holy Spirit came to him, when Christ came to him, and when the Holy Spirit sent the Holy Spirit to bring him to faith in Christ and repentance, he believed. And that was by the power of God. And he says, "But neither in this world, neither in the world to come." If you don't have, what the lesson here is this: if you don't have Christ as your Redeemer, if you don't have Christ as the Lord your righteousness, no sin will be forgiven you here or in the world to come. There's only one way of forgiveness. That's what Christ is speaking of here. And that's what the Holy Spirit does. He brings a sinner to see and know and believe that there's only one way of forgiveness, and that's Jesus Christ crucified and risen from the dead, the Lord our righteousness. So he says in verse 33, "Either make the tree good and his fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and his fruit corrupt, for the tree is known by his fruit." In other words, the work of the Holy Spirit to bring a sinner to Christ, that's the good fruit. But if I preach a false gospel and people flock to my church and I baptize 1,000 and they all believe the false gospel that I believe, what have you got? You've got an evil tree producing evil fruit. It may look good, but it's rotten to the core on the inside. And so he says in verse 34, now look who he's talking to. He's talking to false religion. He says, "O generation of vipers," the poison of asps, see. "How can you, being evil, speak good things?" Well, do you reckon that any of the Pharisees ever said anything good about anything? Well, sure they did. I know false preachers who speak a lot of good in certain areas. But how can you, being evil, speak good things refers to the gospel. How can you preach the true gospel when you're evil? And he says, "For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh." Now that's what Paul's talking about in Romans 3 there. He says, "A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things." Now what is a good man in the scripture? It's a sinner saved by grace, a believer. He got a new heart, and out of that new heart comes his speech, which is Christ, the glory of God in Christ. Now, you may catch him at a moment, and you may hear him say some things he shouldn't say. But when it comes to the way of salvation and the way God saves sinners, he points sinners to Christ and not to anyone else. He said, "An evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment." That's the false gospels. He says, "For by thy words shalt thou be justified." That means vindicated, authenticated. "And by thy words thou shalt be condemned." So those who preach a false gospel, their words condemn them. That's what he's saying. If I come to you preaching salvation conditioned on sinners, what does that tell you about me? What does that tell you about my heart? It tells you I'm a lost person. It tells you I don't know the truth. But if I come to you preaching the gospel consistently now, that's my life. That's my way, all right? And we'll talk about that next week a little bit more. Go back to Romans 3 now. So he says, the poison of asps is under the, verse 14, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Now, the word cursing there is not a Greek word used for foul language. You know what a lot of times in translations it refers to? It refers to prayer to a false god. Praying to a false god. That's the kind of cursing that he's talking about. He's not talking about somebody saying GD or using the F word. That's cursing now. And it's bad. You can't even hardly watch TV or go to a movie now. That's just in every other word in a script. And that's bad. But what Paul's talking about is the curse that is evidenced by a person praying to a false god, leaning, trusting a false god. And the term bitterness there is the term, you remember when, see if I've got it listed, yeah. Bitterness is the same word used to describe the gall of bitterness that Peter spoke of in Acts 8:23, referring to Simon the sorcerer. Remember, he wanted to buy the gifts of the Holy Spirit. He says, you're in the gall of bitterness. He's not talking, you know people who have a personality that's kind of like a bitter kind of personality. I know those kind of people too. I hope I'm not one of them. Maybe if you catch me at the right moment. But that's not what Paul's talking about here. He's talking, Esau, in Hebrews chapter 12, isn't it? I've got that listed too here. In Hebrews chapter 12, he talks about the root of bitterness. The root of bitterness. And you remember Esau was in that because of he wouldn't come to repentance. What he's talking about in the cursing and the bitterness there are things that people say that are opposed to the blessing and the joy that God's people get from hearing Christ preached. You see what I'm saying? That blessing, we have the blessing of fellowship. We can worship God in spirit and in truth. We can praise God through Christ. We have a mediator. We have an intercessor, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he's the joy of his people. Doesn't mean we're all the time going to be happy and never bitter in times in our own minds and our own spirit, but it means that what the message of salvation, all right, it doesn't bring cursing and bitterness to us. It brings us a right relationship with God, enjoying the security of God's grace, standing upon the rock, Christ Jesus. Now, one of the things that we need to understand, here's the lies of Satan pouring forth through the ministers, false preachers, as they speak his words. Remember, Christ told the Pharisees, "You're of your father the devil. The deeds of your father you do." He was a liar from the beginning. He told not the truth. He was a murderer from the beginning. Well, Christ ministers, his glory, his joy, his blessing pours forth through their message when they point sinners to Christ. And what the Holy Spirit does, he brings them to confess. He gives them a new heart, doesn't he? The regenerate heart in the new birth, and he brings them to confess from that new heart with their mouth the Lord Jesus, believing in their heart that God raised him from the dead. Now, what does that mean? Well, he says, "For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." With the new heart, we look to Christ for righteousness and confess salvation with our mouths. Salvation by the grace of God. And then I close this lesson out with Philippians 3. You can look at that where Paul said, here's his confession of his new heart. "What things were gained to me, now I count but loss for Christ. I do count them but dung that I may win Christ and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ." All right.